Hello everyone, welcome to Hue at Home. I'm Tracy Koga. I have a definite great read for you if you love music. It's called Moments in Time by Tom Locke. And let's just say that it is a very, very interesting read, and you can listen to the music too as well. And let's leave it to Tom to tell us the rest of the story. Well, welcome to Hue at Home, Tom. It is so good to see you. And I was just saying, if you are a music lover, then you will love your book, Moments in Time. And it is an incredible, I think, tribute to music from the 50s, 60s, and 70s. And you are a walking encyclopedia. Oh my goodness. But you are a lover of music, right?
Oh, I do love music. It's funny though, over the years, the more and more you get involved in music and the stuff you love, the less you know and more humbled by what has been produced in the past that you uncover along the way, which is most exciting as well.
Okay, so let's talk about your journey on even bringing together all this information. How did you prepare and how did you collect all of it?
Well, it's really interesting. We almost could take a step back, if we will. We'll go back to the early 70s. I grew up in Toronto, and my parents listened to pretty much middle-of-the-road station, CFRB, if that call letter means anything to you. It was a very prominent station in Canada at the time. Well, they would pipe in some syndicated shows, and one of them was by the master, I humbly refer to as the master, Paul Harvey, who had a very different cadence on air, and it would be good day and tell the rest of the story. He had a special piece called The Rest of the Story. Now, how he framed that was fascinating. He would get on and give you some facts and clues about something that is sort of nebulous at the time. Go to a commercial, then come back, weave it all together, and tell you the rest of the story. So that stuck with me for years. And so with my love for music and going on being a collector for a number of years, I got, think about this. You're driving to work, and a guy comes on and starts telling you some information, facts, tidbits about a song or an artist. You can't quite put it together. They go to commercial, gives you a chance, think through it. They come back, tell the rest of the story, and then play the record. A nice 5-minute soundbite. I think, you know what? This is interesting. So that stuck with me for a number of years. So I produced my own 5-piece demo. I did 5 stories similar to what you had here, and actually took it to Nashville, believe it or not, in the mid 80s. Some of my top friends in Nashville, because I come from the film side, and they used to produce all the TV commercials for radio stations. So their clientele were radio personalities. The people that worked with them were also radio personalities. Well, they went, that's nice, Tom, but nobody wants sound bites. We want, you know, Casey Kasem's, you know, hour, 2-hour Dick Barclay's, you know, rock and roll show like that. So it just went by. It's all about timing, you know, as you probably could gather anything else. So I thought, okay, that's fine. So now we fast forward. It's 1997. I'm now living in Vancouver. And my good friend, Michael Godin, who was formerly the A&R guy for A&M Records, discovered Bryan Adams and groups like that, the Payolas. He said, Tom, I think the internet's the new wave. He said, I'm going to go back, because he was a former disc jockey in Montreal, and I'm going to produce an internet radio show called Treasure Island Oldies. He said, Michael, that's fantastic. So he sat down, he mapped it out on his kitchen table to me 25 years ago, may I add, and he said, you know, I need some hooks, some little cameo type pieces. I said, well, I got an idea. And I laid out my Moments in Time idea based on, you know, the format that I love, that Paul Harvey, you know, got me endeared to. Michael said, good, let's go with it. So we started doing them. We've been doing them since August of 2000. And so I've done over 1,000 of these over the years. So a number of his listeners, they're worldwide, but a number of his real close in the chat room and all these wonderful things, started bugging me. He said, Tom, you got to put some of these into a book. We think it would be great. So finally got around to it. And this is where I sort of pause a bit and say, thank you, COVID. I know that sounds a little unusual, but my travel time diminished pretty much close at home in a bubble due to some family situations as well around us. And I went, hey, I can take this off the corner of my desk, put it in front, and let's go through it. Now, the challenge, which 120 tunes do I pick? Like, this has 12 chapters, 10 tunes per chapter. I picked, that also would be impactful to the audience. It's not about me, it's about the listeners. That's the big thing about this book, may I add. This is not about me. It's about the music we grew up with and the memories that were instilled by these, you know, musical interludes that we had during our life. So that's how it all evolved and came about. And then I said, well, I want to get this out sooner than later. So I took the courageous step, as Peter Drucker would say, my old business guy. Hey, you know, let's publish it, which I did.
Well, and when you say that it is for the people, you have a QR barcode after each little chapter that brings back those memories, which is so clever because that ties it all in. Well, hey, I mean, that was a given. That was genius.
It is. And again, thanks to COVID. So when you take a look at the target audience for this group, you know, which are a little more senior, although there are two because their kids and their grandkids are getting into this to buy them the book, strangely enough. The beauty of with COVID, it helped us out. People started to understand what QR codes were because of their vaccination cards. Yeah. They had to go to a restaurant. So this was some good fortune. You got to always look at the opportunities or the challenges, you know?
I know. Oh my God. I put my hand up too, going, what the heck? I have to put my phone? Okay, what do I do? No. It is so wonderful. And there, like you say, there's something for everyone. I want to go back, though, to Paul Harvey. I think that was the name of the person that inspired you. What a way for a DJ. If you think about how radio was back then to what radio is now today, why? The biggest thing is the weather and where the traffic is. And that's it. I don't think these, and correct me if I'm wrong, these DJs know really anything about any of the music. Just from what they can go on their phone and look on social media.
Yeah, it's a very interesting thing. And as a sidebar reference to my book, some of the DJs who've now gone online, streaming and that with their shows or podcasts, some of them a little older, have come back and told me straight out that my book has become a reference book for them, which I take quite an honor. That was very, very, very great to hear because I knew there was some value in it. Mm-hmm. But you know, you make a great point. When I was growing up in the late 50s and early 60s in Toronto, and that DJ was part of your brand, like who you listen to on the radio, not the station so much, the actual DJ. They were larger than life and very, very strong. When artists came to town and they would go out with the artists and performing, they get asked for their autographs as much as the artists would. They were true personalities. Mm-hmm. And they lived and loved what they did.
Yeah, and I really think that we're really missing that disconnect from radio and music. Because that's why we started off with radio, is for entertainment. Then it came for the information and, oh, we can do the sports or whatnot. But because we're constantly saying radio is dying, but this book is a Bible of how much we needed it. And it truly is a gift. Let's talk, I guess there's so many stories in there, but what pops to mind, and I'm sure this is a question you get asked a gajillion times, but what are some of your favorites in the book?
Wow, that's really interesting question because they are so many, because when I wrote these, there was a kinship for me with a lot of the songs that I put in that I think if I put a twist on it would, you know, bring out some value to people. But one of them that I just started harking back at how powerful timing was in the marketplace and what could happen. There's one story in there about a lady Her name was Ruth Brown. 1957, she comes on for Atlantic Records. Now, everybody who's into my type of music will know about the Drifters and all these wonderful groups. But she is the one that really got Atlantic Records going. She was known as Miss Rhythm. However, when people talk about Atlantic Records, they refer to them as the house that Ruth built, which is sort of a play on words with Babe Ruth, who built, you know, Yankee yes. Stadium. They call that the house that Ruth built. But that's how impactful that she was, you know, in the marketplace today. So I had to tell, you know, one of her story in there. So that's why Ruth Brown is in there. But it wasn't just a one-hit wonder. She was the real deal, you know? And the other thing is, some people in books, if we had dictionaries, okay, and we took the word, we could put a picture beside a piece. Well, I would have to take Joan Jett and put her beside the word tenacity. Mm-hmm. And I tell that story because we tell in the book about, you know, I love rock and roll, which has become an anthem. You know, it was like 1982 when she had it as a hit and on the charts for six straight weeks. However, it took her about a year and a half to get there. There was a group in England originally did it called The Arrows. And this mm-hmm. the song was actually an answer song to a Rolling Stone record saying, you know, it's only rock and roll, but I like it. So The Arrows said, no. This, you know, I love rock and roll. So they wrote this piece. It was on a B-side of it. It went nowhere. Joan Jett at the time listened to it. She was with the Runaways, by the way, at that time, the group. And she goes, you know, I like this song. We want to do this song. Can we do it? And the group says, yeah, go nuts. Fill your boots. Well, never materialized. She came back home, put her new group together, Joan Jett and the Blackhearts, and they put it out. Well, the radio stations at that time, you know, we're talking of, they get split up into different genres. So mm-hmm. her challenge was, yeah, it wasn't punk enough, so they wouldn't put it on the punk station. And the other guy goes, no, it's too heavy, it's too rock, we're not putting it on our station. So what she does, for touring, for about 12 straight months, that's the piece that she opens her show with, and she gets branded with that record to a point that it comes out and it gets finally hits the airwaves. So kudos to her, you know? Mm-hmm. In her case, I talk about timing. She made the timing.
Wow, that's so neat. And if you kind of think of it now too, how do you get songs out? And I mean, there's actually some really cool stories on how these artists did get their songs to the radio stations, but a lot of it was just knocking on doors and here's my cassette tape or here's my little demo tape.
You got it. But people, so as the music started to happen in the mid-50s, there's a real emphasis with R&B coming on, and this new demographic called the teenager really started to evolve during that period. The teenager at that time actually was affluent, had some money to go up and purchase these records. So the record companies picked up right away. But also did some guys who set up independent little labels. And guys you talk about say, hey, we'll take this group from the street corner, mm-hmm. you know, in New York here, and we're going to put them together. And we'll get out. Maybe we'll get lucky and go door to door and try to get it to the right DJ who'll play it for us, because they could play anything they wanted. It wasn't top 40. It wasn't a demand list all the time. So that helped a bit. And you know what? A little bit of luck never hurt anybody. In my research, you wouldn't believe the number of records I found that were regional hits. Let's say, big in New York, big in Philadelphia. We never heard them in Toronto. We never heard them in Chicago. But there were huge, huge hits there. But they didn't have the ability or the money, the marketing to push forward. Not everybody had Colonel Tom Parker that Elvis had, you know, down the line. Not to take away from Elvis' talents, phenomenal. But as a team, these guys were phenomenal in getting Elvis's brand into the marketplace and getting his records sold. So it's always been a fascinating part of the business to me. And I'm glad you brought it up.
Oh, it's so true. for you, I guess, Tom, I mean, it's a passion, but your personal journey, and what did you gain putting this book out for yourself?
Thanks for asking that. What I gained out of that is that when you look at the book, it's a legacy book in disguise, in a sense that this isn't what's in here, should not, you know, be forgotten, should not go away. So here's an inkling, one that's trying to preserve some of that great history of the time and talking about the cultural impacts, you know, that some of the songs not only had, but what was going on when those songs came out. So that to me was a great thing that I got from it. And you know, the other biggest thing is when I wrote this book, I'm a pretty upbeat guy, probably could tell, but I gotta tell you, I was getting a little grumpy, you know, during COVID, and I think everybody else was. So one of the drivers for me for this book was putting a smile back in people's faces. Oh. Music does that. Now, what you would listen to a song and what I would listen to a song will conjure up different memories. And that's why I love theater of the mind. That's why good radio will not go away. I think we're seeing good radio morphing into the podcast, you know, area, and people are, you know, branding themselves with this look, or, hey, I like this guy's sound, and yeah, I have time for this. And it's no different than radio. And I don't think it'll ever go away, because the beauty of the difference, field I come from, the film entertainment industry, when you're watching it, you're looking in. With audio and sound, you're back. You can do and other things. Big difference.
Yeah, wow. Very wise. You're like the Obi-Wan Kenobi of music and entertainment. I want to know more. And you know, of course, the movies and film, and that is all a total other conversation to be had. So don't go away.
Sure.
Tom, we're going to have you back. I want to talk about where radio is heading and what the 80s, 90s, and 2000s would be. Who would be in that book? And are there really, like, stories like that are as rich and as equal as in your moments of time? So don't go away. Tom will be
all
back.
Right.
We're going to take a short break. Actually, we're going to visit the hive, see what's buzzing over there. And no, they don't make honey. They actually do rock climbing. So it's a fabulous facility, and it's a great way for kids to burn off some steam, and also adults. You're watching Hue at Home.
Corey, I'm the managing partner of The Hive in Winnipeg. So The Hive is a climbing and fitness facility, so we're bouldering only, which means no ropes or harnesses. We use mats for protection. And with that, we set boulder problems on the wall where you're going to be climbing routes that are different colors and encourage you to problem solve and kind of figure out how to move your body through space, and gives you a bunch of different options to try of all abilities.
It takes disciplined, self-discipline to take on some of these feats, you know, just looking around at the different walls. It's a lot of fun. I love it. Like, I'm still a beginner, but if I had the time to get out here more often, I'd be here every night.
So climbing is great because it has a little bit of social, physical, and mental aspects to it. So that problem-solving aspect is a big component. It's like a physical puzzle, but it also creates like a bit of a social community where you're working with the people nearby to figure out how to get through it. And it's great for your health, mentally and physically, in that sense. But the four pillars of our business are climbing, education, health and wellness, and community, and those aspects all kind of come together to create like a five-star climbing experience by working in that social, mental, and physical realm to work together in that activity that's a little bit beyond that traditional fitness.
I'd say if you're looking for a good time, if you're looking to challenge yourself, or if you're looking to just hang out and be around friends and family, it's a very warm place to be, and it can be exciting.
Welcome back to Hue at Home. I have Tom Locke as our special guest. He is the author of Moments in Time. It is about music, but really it is the stories. And now, Moments in Time was about the 50s, 60s, and 70s and brought back a lot of good memories. Now we're going to go moving forward, and it still might be history or the future for a lot of people in this instance, but the 80s, 90s, and 2000s. But Tom, we want to sort of talk, I think, more about the evolution of music, especially rock and roll, because when we think of music, it was rock and roll. I guess if we think of music today, it's pop or pop rap or something like that, right?
Yep. Well, let me see if I can do this in through a picture, okay? I want you to think of a lake, okay, and tributaries coming into the lake first up, okay? So this lake we're going to call rock and roll, okay? So what came in during the 30s, the 40s, and the 50s, all this different music? We had rhythm and blues, you know, certainly coming in. There was the boogie-woogie sound. There was the jazz. There was the big band sound coming in. We had country, which was back then known and not put down, called hillbilly music, believe it or not. That's coming in. And then down, and then we had stuff like swamp rock and music coming out of Louisiana coming in to mixes. They all came together, and they put this all together, and then we started spinning off of rockabilly, and then rock and roll, as it was called. Today, so that was the birth of rock and roll. Today, I look at rock and roll as the grandfather. We go back to the lake, take a look at all the spin-offs. You know, you got rap, punk, hard rock, classic rock, all spun out of the rock and roll era down the line. One thing remains the same, though. One thing remains the same. Good music passes the test of time. Mm-hmm. And the arrangements may change, to meet the demand or the taste of the audience at that time. But you have some music even today, kids listen to 80s, 90s and stuff, and I'll find out, oh no, wait a minute, that's a redone song from such and such, or redone from there. No different than the 50s and 60s, thought it was all new. It wasn't. It was just rearranged in a lot of cases. There certainly was a lot of music that was created in the period of time, but influenced all the time. To give you an idea of what I found fascinating, when rock and roll first came, it was pretty raw, okay? Mm-hmm. It was pretty raw format coming in, and people were out there. So now we come to the end of the 50s, okay? five interesting things happen. Elvis Presley gets drafted. Okay, keep that in mind. Okay. Little Richard says, "Hey, I'm going back to gospel music, back to my roots. I'm out of here." Chuck Berry has a big statutory rape problem and saying he's put in prison. Okay. Jerry Lee Lewis, who was at the pinnacle of them all, ends up marrying his 14-year-old cousin, and that didn't sit well. That happened when he was in England. It just flew apart. And then sadly, on February 3rd, 1959, Buddy Holly, the Big Bopper, and Richie Valens died in a plane crash. And these iconic people were what was looked up to. We go into the early 60s, and also, I'm bringing, again, remember, this is my opinion, top 40s comes in, where the establishment is going, oh, you're going to play this, no rotation, so nobody can get in and, you know, flip a record. The DJs are told you're into this format deal. So they get into doing that. The music got very homogenized. We had Bobby V, Bobby Vinton, Bobby Curtola. It was like the Bobby era, as I loosely would call it. Suddenly, the British invasion comes. Okay? The British invasion comes. And all of a sudden, we had the Beatles, Stones, the Kinks, you know, the Animals, all coming in. I name those four groups specifically because they redid them, they were influenced by them, were the guys from rock and roll at the beginning. It was the Chuck Berry's, the Little Richards, and got even toured and played with them. This helped North America actually rediscover the roots of rock and roll was through that British invasion period. So now, let's move forward to the 70s, you know, and the 80s, and we got factions coming up. We got disco, which is a spin-off of jive music and only, you know, doubles the beat. We get into the 80s, 90s, 2000s. Listen to the interviews to those people, and they're going to tell you about, oh, yeah, well, you know, the Beatles, you know, the Animals, you know. They'll talk about what they heard, you know, growing up, how impressed they were with the groups. Springsteen will tell you guys that these are the guys that really motivated moving forward, you know, and like the Rascals and all these groups, but they go back to these groups that they grew up with. So when I start listening to music sometimes in the 80s and 90s, I listen, I go, that reminds me of this group. And it's amazing. There's a core of groups that I grew up with, like the Rascals I mentioned, and I can hear it. You know, in some of the music, some of the groups, you know, moving forward now. And I find that very exciting. I think that's great. Yeah. Now, there's been a whole new way how to write, put together, present songs in the marketplace. I think for women, it's been stronger than ever. I think it's terrific. When I heard Adele come out, I was taken back. I thought she was great. I said, could we have another, you know, woman that's really, you know, got it going in that. And I've seen a lot of, you know, great perform. Beyonce is, you know, remarkable. I mean, Jennifer Lopez, the multi-talent in all the areas that she is. And I'm not even scratching the surface.
And you are right, because I think in the next book, because I'm already hoping that you'll write it, it's going to be about women and artists of color, I think, too, as well, because, you know, that really... it wasn't an issue, but it is an issue now, and we all know that. And it's funny, if I go back to, you know, new artists or music of today, all looking backwards in time and being influenced by the classics, Ed Sheeran was up again for another copyright lawsuit or whatever, and he was the one saying, how do you not, when there's 65 million new songs released on Spotify every day or something around the world, and there's only the same 12 chords that, or how many, there's a finite number of music chords that you have as a vocabulary. So we are going to get spin-offs, or oh, that sounds like something. My question to you then, Tom, what is new music? Then what is really original music? And is that the stuff that we kind of go, it's like abstract art going, oh, I love that, I get that. And like you're going and cringing going, I don't understand it.
creativity is always inspired by something. So here in the music, you're inspired by this. Like I use an example in the book. We talk about, it's a rock around the clock. And a lot of people argue it's one of the first rock and roll songs of all time. And it is. But if you ever listen to Moving On Over by Hank Williams Sr., you're going to hit the, you talked about the 12 chords. You're going to hear those, that same rhythm in there and going, wait a minute, they ripped that off. They probably didn't. You know, it just happened. George Harrison, My Sweet Lord, mm-hmm. is supposed to be He's So Fine by the Chiffons. He's going, what? I mean, I didn't even make the connection until I slowed it down and listened to the tune. And so, oh, God, you get subconscious plagiarism? I mean, what's that? So we do have that challenge. I've heard in some certain rhythm and beats, a lot of Santana's music, if you listen to Santana, mm-hmm. and you can match Santana, you know, with Ann and others too. But yeah, so there, the limit is the creative. And I've also heard stories where somebody's created something on the, you know, the West Coast, guy created it in New York, and you hear the songs, you're going, holy mackerel, you know, how did that happen? So that doesn't surprise me.
No.
At all. So what's happening, though, that's caused some confusion, the guy says, oh, that sounds like mine. I'm going to sue him unless you give me a credit to it. So now you're seeing songs, you know, a simple credit. I mean, we used to see in my day, one, two, maybe three guys. Now you're seeing a list of credits bigger than the label.
That's just so they don't get sued. Oh, we just have a couple of more minutes or so. The state of radio. And like you said, you see the future of radio moving into podcasts, and we've already seen this. And this show is a podcast too as well. So it is those good conversations. But I'm kind of talking now commercial radio. Where do you see that going?
Mm-hmm. In my heart, if I speak from my heart, I think there's always something for commercial radio. Our challenge is, which I took advantage of, is the soundbite nature of things. Am I going to give up a half an hour of my time? You know, mm-hmm. Well, I can listen to it on radio. So that is a challenge. It's like, you know, your boss Jock coming on for, you know, 2, 3, 4 hours. Well, that maybe works in XM radio if you're listening to a certain, you know, network, and that's what you want because you want commercial free going forward. There's one of the rubs. It's the commercial aspects of it, for sure. So, boy, I think it's a real tough piece and moving forward. So is it a case where we entertain people by creating 5-minute segment features, say like my moment on their show, so people will turn in for that piece? So, hey, I got them at that time, and I can put bumpers around it for commercials if that's an angle. I mean, these are some of the things that really have to be thought through. I also believe that maybe we can go back to something. In the early days of television, and they used to, you know, call it soaps all the time. You know, we're watching a soap on TV. That's because they were sponsored by soap, you know, companies, right? You know, so is it going to happen, you know, that Procter & Gamble sponsors, you know, new broadcasting? You know, could that be the future? Could that be the revenue stream where you're matching a title with an internet product? This mm-hmm. podcast show is brought to you by mm-hmm. blah, 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 in order to be in the marketplace. So I don't think that's so far-fetched, but that may be a way we can go for the future. But I do believe that, you know, long people on for an hour, 2 hour, I think they've got to be really nailed to their audience. Really got to, it's not just mm-hmm. a general, it's going to be a probably very niche.
Yes.
Niche broadcasting moving forward. And which, you know, in disguise format, if you look at XM, you know, radio, they have right. done that by breaking
stuff everything down. Yes, yeah. No doubt. Oh, well, it's such a big question, and I know that there's just so much out there now with this thing called the internet and everything like that and social media. But anyways, this little book is such a gem. I want to thank you, Tom, for sharing your time with us and yeah. giving insight into what was behind this book. And I really encourage people to buy it. Like you said, It's a great little book to give to your grandkids or whatever and say, hey, this is the music we used to listen to. And
we can do it instantly. I'll give you a little story.
Okay.
And that to my brother. And he said, you know, this is the perfect bathroom book. And I said, what do you mean? See, all the stories are only 2 pages, okay? Again, because of our, you know, attention span. He says, good. He says, I go in, I read the 2 pages, I click on the QR code, and I'm good to go.
Oh, my goodness. On that note, thank you so much, Tom. All the best and good luck with the book.
Thank you so much, Tracy. Have a good and all the best to you and your show.
So The Hive is a climbing and fitness facility. So we're bouldering only, which means no ropes or harnesses. We use mats for protection. But the 4 pillars of our business are climbing, education, health and wellness, and community. And those aspects all kind of come together to create like a 5-star climbing experience.
I want to give a very special thank you to all of our guests on today's show and leave you with this question. What would be your favorite song and why? We want to know, so send us an email to hello@ilikehue.com or message us on Facebook and Instagram at iLikeHue. And as well, I am giving away this book, Moments in Time. So you can email us at hello@ilikehue or message us on Facebook and Instagram at iLikeHue. And just let's say that you'd be interested in this book, so leave your name and contact information. Good luck. And as always, stay safe and healthy. And we'll see you next time on Hue at Home.